أعوذ بالله من الشيطان الرجيم بسم الله الرحمن الرحيم ألم تر كيف ضرب الله مثلا كلمة طيبة كشجرة طيبة أصلها ثابت وفرعها في السماء تؤتي أكلها كل حين بإذن ربها ويضرب الله الأمثال للناس لعلهم يتفكرون صدق الله العلي العظيم. In one of the rooms, small rooms adjacent to the mosque of the Prophet ﷺ, a room that was built by the hands of the Prophet for his noble daughter Fatima al-Zahra alayhis salam, a baby was born on the 15th of Ramadan, such a day. On the third year of the Hijrah, on the second year of the Hijrah, Amirul Mu'mineen alayhi salatu wasalam was married to the daughter of the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, and Fatima alayhi salam conceives with her first baby boy on the third year of the Hijrah, in the middle of the month of Ramadan. Lady Fatima alayhi salam delivers this little baby boy. The news were broke and the Prophet rushed to that room. The room is very close to him. He goes inside the room and he says, I want to see the baby. They give him the baby. He wraps the baby in a piece of cloth. And then he says, Allahumma inni u'iduhu wa wilduhu min ash-shaytan ar-rajim. And then he recites the adhan in his right ear, the iqama in his left one. And then he asks his parents, Ali and Fatima alayhim as-salam, Mada asmaytumuh? What did you name this baby? Amir al-Mu'mineen answers him, he says, مَا كُنَّا لِنَسْبِقَكَ يَا رَسُولَ اللَّهِ. We would never mention, we would never give a name to this baby before you. You have to give the name. And the Prophet answers, وَمَا كُنْتُ لِأَسْبِقَ رَبِّي. And I would never give him a name before my Lord. Immediately Jibreel descend. Jibreel alayhi salam descends. With this name, he says, Ya Rasulallah, Inna Allah Ta'ala Al-Aliyyul A'la Yuqri'uka As-Salam. He sends his greetings to you and he says, this first grandson of you, the first, very first grandson of the Prophet Sallallahu Alaihi Wasallam, will carry the name of Al-Hasan. And therefore the Imam was named Al-Hasan ibn Ali alayhi as-salam. Sallu ala Muhammad wa ala Muhammad.
Allahumma salli ala Muhammad wa ala Muhammad.
The Prophet said to him, Ya Hasan, laqad ashbahta khalqi wa khuluqi. You resemble me in my features, physical features. And also you resemble me in my manners, in my akhlaq. Because he's the product of the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam. He was raised at the hand of the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam in Medina. Those two boys, Hassan and Hussein, the period between them is only 10 months. Imam Hassan is older than his son, Imam Hussein, by only 10 months. They were raised together at the hands of the first teacher, the first muallim, the first educator, the seal of the messengers, Muhammad sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. Therefore they inherited the manners, the akhlaq, وَإِنَّكَ لَعَلَىٰ خُلُقٍ عَظِيمٍ, the akhlaq of their grandfather. And he raised them, he protected them, he shielded them, and he also said, Al-Hassan wal-Hussein Sayyida Shababi Ahli al-Jannah. In numerous occasions, the Prophet would point to these two boys as being the masters of the youth of paradise. So Imam Hassan was with his grandfather until the age of seven. At the age of seven, the Prophet ﷺ left this lower life, al-hayat al-dunya. He left this lower life to meet his Lord. And therefore, Al-Hassan was in the custody of his father and mother. And fortunately, he saw the tragic death of his mother at a very young, tender age. But these tragedies built their characters, made them stronger boys, stronger men. And he was on the side of his father, Amir al-Mu'mineen, the senior advisor to his father, Amir al-Mu'mineen, alayhi salatu wassalam, until his father ultimately was murdered during this month. In a few nights, we're going to commemorate the Shahada, the martyrdom of Amir al-Mu'mineen, alayhi salatu wassalam, and Imam Hassan was at the age of 37. When Amir al-Mu'mineen was killed in Mihrab al-Salat, in the sanctuary of the prayers in the Grand Mosque in Kufa, the Muslim Ummah agreed that Imam Hassan is going to succeed him. They paid allegiance to him, al-Bay'ah. But then there was a dictator in Syria at that time by the name of Muawiyah ibn Abi Sufyan, who hijacked the power during the reign of the second caliph. Muawiyah became the governor of Syria, Sham, during the reign of Umar ibn al-Khattab. Umar ibn al-Khattab was the one who appointed Muawiyah to be the governor, the hakim of Syria. And within 20 years of his dictatorship, he consolidated his power in Syria. And therefore, he refused to pay allegiance to Imam Ali alayhi salam when Imam Ali became the Khalifa. He refused. And you all heard about the Battle of Safin. The Battle of Safin had 70,000 casualties. 70,000 people were killed in the Battle of Safin because Muawiyah refused to accept Imam Ali as the Caliph. And he mobilized his troops. Those people who were brainwashed, people like ISIS today, who joined his army to come and fight the legitimate caliph, Amir al-Mu'mineen, Ali ibn Abi Talib, alayhi salatu wasalam. And then after the murder of Imam Ali in Kufa, he also refused, Muawiyah refused to accept Imam Hassan as the caliph or pay allegiance to him. And he threatened him that as I did with your father, I stood against him, I will do the same against you. So you have to quit. No way I am going to let you rule over the Muslim Ummah. And this is exactly what he did. The first wave of soldiers and his army were fighting against Imam Ali in Safin. And the second wave, the second war, also started during the time of Muawiyah, this time against Imam Hassan alayhi salam. Unfortunately, the people of Iraq were exhausted, tired. The people of Syria at that time, they were supplied by Muawiyah and his government by money, by weapon, by food. So they were ready to fight the legitimate army. But that legitimate army, that legitimate army was powerless, although they had the best leader. But if the grassroots is not willing to fight, then the leader cannot fight by himself. And therefore, there were some skirmishes between the army of Muawiyah, who attacked the army of Imam Hassan. Unfortunately, the army of Imam Hassan was defeated because people were unwilling to fight, to go for jihad. They were unwilling. Imam Hassan says, والله ما سلمت الأمر إلى معاوية إلا لأنني لم أجد أنصار. وَلَوْ وَجَدْتُ أَنصَارًا لَقَاتَلْتُهُ لَيْلِي وَنَهَارِي حَتَّى يَفْتَحُ اللَّهِ بَيْنِي وَبَيْنَ. I surrendered to Muawiyah because I did not have helpers. I did not have supporters. People were unwilling to come with me and stand for the truth. And this is the same not only with Imam Hassan, with many of the prophets of Allah, beginning with Noah, thousands of years ago. Noah alayhi salam says, Rabbi inni da'awtu qawmi laylan wa naharan falam yazidhum du'ai illa firara. I keep inviting them to the truth, to justice, to be true human beings, to live up to their responsibilities, but they keep running away from me, firara. The same thing with Ibrahim. I mentioned the story of Ibrahim last time. Ibrahim was born in southern Iraq. He's the native of Iraq, near the city of Nasiriyah today. This is his birthplace. But why Ibrahim is buried in Palestine? Because they drove him out of the country. The Supreme Court, at that time, 300 judges, they gathered in the Supreme Court, 5,000 years ago, 4,000 years ago. And they sentenced Ibrahim alayhi salam to send him to, some said, let's sentence him to death. Others said, no, death is too much for him. Let's send him into exile. Kick him out of this land. 300 judges. They decided that Ibrahim is not fit to be the citizen of this town because he destroyed the idols. He destroyed the idols. So he doesn't, we would not allow him to stay in this land. So he was expelled, Ibrahim, and he had no supporters. He had no supporters when he was expelled. The same thing with Musa. Musa had to run away from Egypt, go to Palestine, and then come back to Egypt again. فَفَرَرْتُ مِنْكُمْ لَمَّا خِفْتُكُمْ. Musa says, I ran away from my home, from my land, because they plotted against me, and I had no supporters. The same thing with Isa, the same thing with the Prophet Muhammad sallallahu alaihi wasallam. Prophet Muhammad was driven out of Mecca because he had no supporters. And Allah said to him, don't worry. إِنَّ الَّذِي فَرَضَ عَلَيْكَ الْقُرْآنَ لَرَادُّكَ إِلَى مَعَدْ. Ya Rasulullah, don't worry, I'll bring you back to Mecca. For 13 years he could not go to his home, to his town. For 13 years. And then he was able to go, just before the end of his life, during Fathu Mecca. So these leaders, those leaders, because of lack of support, unfortunately, sometimes they have to surrender. Sometimes they have to surrender. And this is what happened to Imam Hassan, because he faced the most dishonest, deceitful, cunning political leader. And that was Muawiyah ibn Abi Sufyan. Muawiyah in Syria, he ruled in Syria since the time of Umar, Umar ibn Khattab, through the time of Uthman, and the almost five years of Imam Ali. He was ruling in Syria, and he was able to alter the Quran, the teachings of the Quran, to change them, and to brainwash the people, and to portray himself as being the messenger of God, as being the purest leader. He was able to brainwash the people. Some people he will purchase them with money, some people he will brainwash them. Brainwash them through what? The same problem we face in America today, with the media. Let me ask you, what does the media think about Muslims in America? Do they have good perception of the Muslims? Are we reflected in the media in America in a good way or in a bad way? Definitely in a bad way. Why? Because Muslims are bad? You are bad people here? You are not bad. You are God-fearing, law-abiding. You came to this country to build the land, to contribute. Not because you are bad, but because there are some people who run the media. They don't want people to know the truth. This is exactly what Muawiyah ibn Abi Sufyan did. Muawiyah would stand on the minbar, not only him, thousands of preachers who work for him, and he will ask the preachers to curse Imam Ali during Salatul Jummah. During Salatul Jummah. 60 years Imam Ali being cursed. 60 years, my friend. 60 years. This is very, very painful. At least he's the son-in-law of the Prophet. He's the husband of Fatima alayhi salam. Even today, there are some people who don't like Imam Ali. They are Muslims. I was watching a clip 2 days ago. A Wahhabi scholar who is speaking about Mubahala. The story of Mubahala took place in Medina between the group of the Christians who came from Najran, southern part of Arabia. They came to discuss Jesus with the Prophet, and then the Prophet invited them for Mubahala, confrontation, ideological confrontation, not physical. This guy who's reading the story, he says the Prophet invited, Allah says, فَقُلْ تَعَالَوْ نَدْعُوا أَبْنَاءَكُمْ. The Wahhabi scholar says, listen. So the Prophet brought Hassan and Hussein. وَنِسَاءَكُمْ. So the Prophet brings Fatima to Zahra. And then he skips Imam Ali. He doesn't say وَأَنفُسَكُمْ. It says the Prophet went with Hassan and Hussein and Fatima to Zahra. Ali was missing, alhamdulillah. Even when he read the ayah, he said, فَقُلْ تَعَالَوْ نَدْعُ أَبْنَاءَنَا وَأَبْنَاءَكُمْ وَنِسَاءَنَا وَنِسَاءَكُمْ ثُمَّ نَبْتَهِلْ. He skipped where it says, وَأَنفُسَنَا وَأَنفُسَكُمْ. I have the clip with me, if you want to see it. Why? Because he doesn't like to hear the name of Imam Ali. Today, when people all read the Quran and many memorize the Quran, imagine 1400 years ago, where people did not even know anything about Quran. So, there is some hatred, and hatred is a disease. It's a disease. And this disease is mentioned here. Open the Quran, open the beginning of Surah Al-Baqarah. The right, the beginning of Surah Al-Baqarah, verse number 6. Second page, what does it say? إِنَّ الَّذِينَ كَفَرُوا, those who disbelieve, سَوَاءٌ عَلَيْهِمْ, it doesn't matter for them, أَأَنذَرْتَهُمْ أَمْ لَمْ تُنذِرْهُمْ لَا يُؤْمِنُونَ. Whether you reach out to them and you speak to them and tell them this is the truth, or whether you don't, they would never believe in you. Why? خَتَمَ اللَّهُ عَلَىٰ قُلُوبِهِمْ وَعَلَىٰ سَمْعِهِمْ وَعَلَىٰ أَبْصَارِهِمْ غِشَاوَةٌ وَلَهُمْ عَذَابٌ عَظِيمٌ. Because of their corruption, insistence on evilhood, because of their resistance, Allah has sealed their minds and their hearts. So that they don't understand you and they don't listen to you and they don't respond to you. So don't waste your time. Don't waste your time. This is a disease. This disease was spreading by Muawiyah ibn Abi Sufyan against Amir al-Mu'mineen and Imam Hassan alayhi salam. And therefore, Muawiyah becomes the caliph. For only 6 months, Imam Hassan was Amir al-Mu'mineen, the caliph, and then he surrenders, and Muawiyah takes over. He becomes Amir al-Mu'mineen, wa wali al-Muslimin. He is the leader of all the Muslims. And he was able to rule because of his propaganda machine that he possessed. Not only in Syria, in the entire Muslim region. Where today, let me recite this hadith of the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa alihi wa sallam. And this hadith has been narrated by world-class narrators, huffaz such as Ibn Sa'd in his book, At-Tabaqat al-Kubra, such as Ibn Hajar in his book, Tahdhib al-Tahdhib, such as Al-Dhahabi, by the way, is an anti-Shi'a transmitter of hadith. In his book, Mizan al-I'tidal, those hardcore Sunni leaders, they say, the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, قال, إِذَا رَأَيْتُم مُعَاوِيَةَ عَلَىٰ مِنْبَرِي فَاقْتُلُوهُ أَوْ فَرْجُمُوهُ. If you see one day Muawiyah standing on my podium, on my minbar, then they have to murder him. Muawiyah is unqualified to represent Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. But this is what happened. This is the sad reality. Muawiyah becomes the Amir al-Mu'mineen, and Imam Hassan is, you know, relegated to the corners of his house, because people always follow, according to this book, the Quran, إِن تُطِعْ أَكْثَرَ مَنْ فِي الْأَرْضِ يُضِلُّكَ عَنْ سَبِيلِ اللَّهِ. The vast majority of the people, they, if you want to follow them, they're going to misguide you. The vast majority of people are for dunya, not for akhirah. However, Imam Hassan alayhi salam continued his leadership role, the role of educating people, guiding people, and helping people. One day, someone who was completely brainwashed in Syria by Muawiyah, he comes to Medina for one reason. For one reason, he was searching for Imam Hassan just to curse him right in his face. So he comes, he says, where is Imam Hassan? They tell him, go to the mosque. So he goes there to the mosque and he starts cursing him and his father, Amir al-Mu'mineen, inside Masjid al-Nabi. This is not different from the person who went last Friday to the mosque, Imam al-Sadiq Mosque in Kuwait, and while people were in the state of sujood, he detonated himself and he killed 28 of them. It's not a big difference. We have such ignorance nowadays. So he comes to the Imam and he says, he starts cursing the Imam. Imam says, Imam smiles. In return to this cursing, he smiles. This is the akhlaq. This is how he inherited the akhlaq of Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. He says to him, أَظُنُّكَ يَا شَيْخُ غَرِيبًا. I guess you are a stranger. You don't know me very well. أَظُنُّكَ يَا شَيْخُ غَرِيبًا. فَإِنْ كُنْتَ جَائِعًا أَشْبَعْنَكَ. If you are hungry, come, I will feed you. أَوْ عُرْيَانًا كَسَوْنَاكَ. If you are naked, we will clothe you. أَوْ مُحْتَاجًا أَغْنَيْنَاكَ. If you have a need, we will fulfill it for you. أَوْ طَرِيدًا homeless. طَرِيد is homeless. أَعْوَيْنَاكَ. We will shelter you. The man looks at Imam Hassan. I'm cursing him and cursing his father. And he says, I will shelter you. I will feed you. I will welcome you. Come to my house. The man, see here, every human being has the seed of goodness in him or her. But sometimes these are covered, unfortunately. Covered. So you need someone to go and stimulate that and wake them up and shake them. And this is what Imam did to this man. When he spoke to him with such a compassionate, forgiving tone, the man had no other choice but to say, Allahu a'lamu haythu yaj'alu risalatah. Allah knows best who to choose for imamah, for leadership. And then he said to the Imam, كُنْتَ أَنْتَ وَأَبُوكَ أَبْغَضُ خَلْقِ اللَّهِ إِلَيْهِ وَالْآنْ أَصْبَحْتَ أَنْتَ وَأَبُوكَ أَحَبُّ خَلْقِ اللَّهِ إِلَيْهِ. A minute ago, you and your father, Ali, were the most hated to me, in my eyes. Now, you and your father, Ali, are the most beloved in my eyes. Are the most beloved. The message of Islam is the message of akhlaq. The message of akhlaq. The message of forgiveness. It's not the message of retaliation. Never ever think of retaliating against people. You have to stimulate their conscience. Sometimes people are dead. Your job is to wake them up. Wake them up. That's the message of Islam. To save people, to salvage them. One day a man comes to him and he says to him that I have nothing left for my family. I have no food, nothing at home. I left my family hungry. This is exactly what he says to him. He says, the only man that I know who's going to help you is you. To help me is you. لَنْ يَبْقَ لِي شَيْءٌ يُبَاعُ بِدِرْهَمٍ يَكْفِيكَ رُؤْيَةُ مَنْظَرِي عَنْ مَخْبَرِي. Look at how I look. And you can understand, I don't have to say about my misery, my poverty. The way I look, it tells you a lot about me. يكفيك رؤيته منظري عن مخبري إلا حشاشة ماء وجه صنتها من أن تباع وقد وجدتك مشتري. The only thing which is left for me is my honor and my dignity and my respect. And now I want to sell it to you, Ya Hassan. Imam Hassan alayhi salam immediately answers him with another couplet. He says to him, عاجلتنا فأتاك وابل برنا طلا ولو أمهلتنا لم نقصري فخذ القليل فكن كأنك لم تبع ما صنته وكأننا لم نشتري. Imam says, you came to me as a surprise. I'm not a prepared. Otherwise, I would have prepared things for you. I'm going to give everything that I have now in my house, and you don't have to sell your honor and your dignity to me. You are the one who's doing me a favor. One day, he was passing by a group of poor people. They were eating food. They said, Halumma ilayna ya Abu Rasulullah. Join us for food. Imam immediately sits with them and he eats. And he says, the second meal, you come to my house. It's on me. So they go to his house and he gives them a lot of food. Someone says, Ya Abu Rasulullah, wow, your job is really great. Look at the way you took care of them. He said, no, their job is greater than mine. He said, how? He said, because the day they gave me the food, they gave me everything they had. Everything they own. While today when I gave them, I did not give them everything I own. So they did better than I. Those are our imams. They serve, they help, but at the end of the day, they still feel the shortcomings. They feel that they did not do enough to serve people. They give the credit to the people. One day a man comes with a piece of paper. He puts his request on a piece of paper because he's shy to speak to the imam. So he would give him a piece of paper from behind the door. He knocks at the door and then he gives the paper. He does not want the imam to see his face because he's embarrassed. The imam says immediately, 400 dinar. It's a lot of money, 400 dinar. Do you know the dinar is one golden coin? 400 golden coins to one person? So they said to him, at least Ya Abu Rasulullah, look at his face, ask him, interrogate him to see whether he's genuine, whether he really needs help or not. Imam says, no. No, because the time he waits until I bring him the money, Allah is going to ask me about that time. Because that time is going to cause embarrassment for him. I don't want him to wait any minute. I grant him his need immediately. Those are Ahlul Bayt. This is Kareem Ahlul Bayt, the most generous within the family of the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa alihi wa sallam. One day a lady who gives him a bouquet of flowers, Jari, slave lady, who works in his house, she presents him with a bouquet of flowers. He says, "Anti hurratun li wajhillah." In return to these flowers, I free you. Somebody said to him, "This is too much. She gave you something very little. You free her? You free her?" He says, "This is the teachings of the Quran. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala says in the Holy Quran, "Idha huyitum bi tahiyyatin fahayyu bi ahsani minha aw ruddu." When someone greets you with a greeting, you have to answer that greeting or that gift with a bigger gift. And a bigger gift in this case to her is to free her. Fi sabilillah, li wajhillah, sallallahu alayka ya Sayyidi, wa ya Mawlai, ayyuhal Imam al-Hasan, al-Mujtaba, yabna Rasulillah. This is the product of Amir al-Mu'mineen and Fatimatu al-Zahra. We ask Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala to grant us that tawfiq and the honor to follow the tradition of Ahlul Bayt alayhim as-salam. To follow their example in kindness, in forgiveness, in generosity, in selflessness. We follow their example, so inshallah to be their true Shia and true followers, not only in this life, but we will be gathered with them inshallah on the day of judgment.
أعوذ بالله من الشيطان الرجيم بسم الله الرحمن الرحيم أمن يجيب المضطر إذا دعاه ويكشف السوء 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 أمن يجيب المضطر إذا دعاه يكشف السوء يا الله من على مرضانا بالشفاء والعافية المرضى المنظورين اللهم ألبسهم ثوب الصحة والعافية تقبل منا صلاتنا وصيامنا ودعاءنا في هذا الشهر العظيم واجعلنا من عتقائك من النار وفرج عن المسلمين والمؤمنين في اليمن والعراق وسوريا وجميع بلاد المسلمين وارحم شهداءنا وعجل في فرج سيدنا ومولانا صاحب العصر والزمان اللهم كن لوليك الحجة ابن الحسن صلواتك عليه وعلى آبائه في هذه الساعة وفي كل ساعة وليا وحافظا وقائدا وناصرا ودليلا وعينا حتى تسكنه أرضك طوعا وتمتعه فيها طويلا واجعلنا اللهم من أنصاره وأعوانه تمر إن شاء الله صلاة الجمعة is at 1 PM وإلى أرواح المؤمنين والمؤمنات ثواب الفاتحة مع الصلاة على محمد وآل محمد.